and welcome. Today, we'll be taking a look at the editing process that goes into creating a high-quality photograph that we refer to as a Z-clay print. And basically what constitutes such a print, there's a few criteria. It needs to be at least 300 dots per inch in terms of the resolution, which is basically further than the human eye can resolve. So you're going to actually see something more impressive than what you could experience on a screen. The second factor is it needs to be on archival acid-free paper. And the third factor, it needs to be with pigment-based ink, not dye. So you're actually going to have dissolved solids in pigment-based ink, and they're quite expensive for that reason. It cost me about $700 to replace the entire 12 set of cartridges on my Canon Pro 1000. So you want to be selective with what you're printing, unless you're a billionaire. Okay, let's get me out of the way now. And also a special thank you to Red River, who is sponsoring this video and providing me with the paper that has gone into this Summer Star exhibit, which is the purpose behind this entire video is to give a little insight to the process that I went through with editing, printing, and exhibiting all of these photographs. A lot of different creative decisions had to be made, and some ambiguous environments had to be navigated for sure. But enough about that, let's jump right in. So this is the set that's featured in the exhibit. This was from a solo canoe trip I went on this past October up in Northern Maine on the west branch of the Penobscot River. It was a pretty special experience. I was out there alone for 7 days, 70, 75 miles. Really an opportunity to connect with nature and ground oneself, sort of recalibrate the mind a bit. And I also encountered a few unanticipated events that would prove to be quite trying. But I survived, so there was some growth there. All right. Couple different shots here, some moose. I want to pick a photo for this demonstration that requires a little bit of work rather than something that's ready to go right off the bat. The rabbit seems to be a central star of the show, so let's go with him. This was a pretty bizarre encounter, so I'm paddling along, see this rabbit on a rock out in the middle of the river just hanging out there, kind of in a trance almost, and I was expecting him to take off as soon as I approached, but he just kept hanging out there, and I even offered him a carrot, but he said it wasn't organic and no thank you, sir. But he did let me give him a few back scratches, which was kind of cool. But yeah, I'm not gonna edit that one, so let's take this one. And just to explain a little bit more about this shot, so I took this on my Sony a7 R3 with a 24-70 G Master set at 24 millimeters, so wide angle. This was pretty unique that I was able to get a subject 2 or 3 feet from the camera like that, especially a wild animal. And if you notice up here, you'll see this image is almost 16,000 pixels wide and 10,000 pixels tall. Clearly, my Sony a7 R3, 42 megapixels, is not producing that. So that was actually accomplished using Topaz AI software. And the reason why I essentially doubled the resolution is because I'm doing some large prints with this exhibit. I have prints that are as big as 40 by 60 inches, and you're not gonna, be able to stretch a 42 megapixel raw file that far. So you need to intervene with artificial intelligence to really essentially recreate the image almost. Okay, so this is all edited. This is the point we want to get back to. So let me make a duplicate copy of this. Create virtual copy. Okay. All right, so now we have our copy. Get this out of the way. Oops. Okay. We'll go into the develop mode. and we're gonna reset this. Now we're gonna start from scratch. Also, I don't know why, but for some reason this AI software kind of dulls the image a bit. The original RAW file was better exposed than this, but I figured it would be a good example so we can actually, you know, make some changes here and see how to approach that whole process. And I'd also like to mention that I really try to do almost all of my edits in Lightroom over Photoshop, just because you're going to get the most flexibility from the raw pixel manipulations here versus, you know, doing those same manipulations in Photoshop. It's not going to be as clean. So do as much work as you can in Lightroom, and then, you know, go to Photoshop if you have to do special touch-ups or selective color edits, things like that. And of course, we'll be printing from Photoshop. That's really the primary purpose that I'm using Photoshop, is just as a print control module. Okay, so clearly this is a bit underexposed. Let's do some global adjustments to start. So we'll bring up the exposure a little, and I can already tell it's looking a bit soft. Let's give it a little more punch with some contrast. Are we clipping? Yep, so we can see with this little tab, we're clipping some highlights there. So let's bring down the whites. Okay, I think we're gonna need to go to the highlights instead. Sometimes the highlights will fix the problem, sometimes the whites. Try both, play around. But we just wanna get that to the point where we haven't lost any detail. Okay, this does look a little saturated, so I'm gonna bring down the saturation a bit. And also, if you're wondering what's the difference between vibrance and saturation, vibrance is sort of a relative saturation adjustment, so it will decrease the saturation of the most saturated colors, whereas the saturation slider will apply it globally and treat all colors the same. Okay. And also, I'd just like to point out a lot of beginner photographs tend to bring the saturation the other direction. You know, just try to be mindful of not oversaturating things. You know, color can be excited when you're first getting started, but the fine art element of this whole process starts to emerge with the subtleties and, you know, sometimes bringing down saturation. And maybe you leave one piece, one, you know, small element of the photograph, a certain subject component saturated to draw the viewer's attention toward a particular place. That's really how you get into, you know, storytelling with dodging and burning, trying to create an experience for your viewer as they encounter your photograph. Where does their eye go? How does it navigate and flow through the image? So that's the intent here. All right. So now I'm going to move into some local adjustments. First thing I'm going to do is apply a circular filter. And I'm going to invert this because I actually want to just slightly bring up the overall exposure here to essentially create a vignette. Just in a kind of a roundabout way. I don't want much, just a little bit. 0.14. I'm happy with that. Just a little. Okay. Now, I'm going to grab my brush tool. This is nice because you can control the size right with the wheel on your mouse. It's pretty convenient. So we're going to put the exposure up a bit. You know, keep the flow at about a third, 33, 30 size. Again, we're controlling that with the wheel. Feather, turning that up pretty high. I definitely want this to blend well. So now we're just going to begin to touch up around the face, you know, some areas of the body where we want to draw attention to interesting features like his large feet or the ears. As you can see, the back of the rabbit is starting to get a little out of focus. The plane of focus is up on the front half of the body, so we want to keep the attention there and avoid that. Okay, so let's just start painting in. Just do this, you know, take your time. We're not trying to do this all at once. The idea is to iteratively layer these exposure adjustments upon each other, sort of like painting a painting, right? That's really where, for me, the editing process starts to bring a lot of the artistic element into this, because you become almost a painter in a sense. It's digital, but still. Okay. Make this a little bigger. Now I'm going to zoom in, touch up the eye just a little bit. Just want to put a little emphasis on the outer periphery like that, not too much. Okay. All right. So now, if we hit O on the keyboard, we can see everywhere in red that we've applied these local exposure adjustments. So I'm going to turn that off, and now I can control all of this red area with the adjustments over here. So now we can fine tune it. Okay, we can make it really bright. Just an example, that's way too bright, way too dark. So we just want to, you don't want to overdo this, just bring it up a little bit. Okay, I like it at about 1.35. I'm also going to give it a little more punch with the contrast. And then a little bit of texture, not too much. If you go too much, it looks a little fake. So we'll just put it up to 20 or so. Okay. I'm actually going to bring my blacks down a little, just to, again, give it a little more punch. And also, when you bring your blacks down, you're also increasing the saturation. So I'll bring the blacks down and decrease the saturation to compensate for that just slightly. 13. Okay. All right, so this works for me. I'm happy with this. I'm going to click done. And now we're going to bring this into Photoshop to get it ready for a print. So a quick way to do that, you can just hit Control E on your keyboard. That will automatically open Photoshop for you and pull the image in. Oh, it's on the other screen. There we go. Okay, first thing you want to do, just create a secondary layer here, Control J, a little shortcut for that. And now we need to figure out how big we're going to print this, right? So I think I'll do a 12 by 18 on 13 by 19 paper. So first thing I'm going to do is go up here to image, and then we're going to click image size. And like I mentioned before, you know, for this to be considered a Zicle print, the resolution needs to be 300. So we're going to change that. Anything more than 300, it's really not going to be noticeable. So just, I'd recommend always putting it to 300 for the best quality. And then we're going to change this to 12 by 18. Okay. As far as the resampling, I would recommend just leaving it to automatic. Photoshop is pretty sophisticated with these types of operations. So it's intelligent enough to apply the right one. Okay. All right. That shrunk quite a bit because before it was 15,000 pixels wide. So now we've got it down to a 12 by 18 print. Just bring that back to full screen. Now we're going to put a little bit of sharpening on here. So if we go up to filter, there's a few different ways to apply sharpening. What I've found works the best is to go into smart sharpen. So you can start just by choosing default, you know, see what it plugs in for you. These parameters will affect the image in different ways. So let's put the box on the rabbit's eye so we can see what's going on here. So if I increase the noise reduction parameter, it's simply going to remove grain. I mean, there's not much grain here anyways, so it's not having a huge effect. We'll just leave that around 10. 8, that works. Radius. This is the one you want to be careful with. When you bring this up, things start to look strange. You know, it's increasing the contrast heavily. So let's just keep that away from that effect. Okay, we'll keep that down around 0.7, 1, anywhere in that range is good. I really wouldn't put it over 3 ever. Okay, 0.9 works. And then the amount. So we just want a subtle crisp effect here. If you overdo this, it's going to make the image look superficial. So let's bring it down to 72. That's a good number. We'll apply that, hit OK. Now, if you'd like to see the effect of the sharpening, what you can do is just zoom into an area. The eye seems to be our go-to. And now you can just simply toggle on and off the layer that you applied the sharpening to. So it's very subtle. You probably can't even see it in the video. I can see it here on my screen. It's just giving it a little crispness boost, and that's all we want. All right, so now we are ready to print, the fun part. So let's go over to here, file, print. All right, now this can be a little overwhelming if it's your first time in the dialog box here, but there's really just a few important things we want to pay attention to. So you can see printer, I've got my Canon Pro 1000 all set up. First thing we're going to do is go into print settings, and this is all set up because I just did a print, but you know, let's say this is the first time we were doing this. So the first thing we're going to look at is the media type, and really these four boxes down here are the critical elements. So for media type, you're going to want to select the type of paper you're working with. In my case, I created a custom media type for the Red River Palo Duro soft gloss rag, which we'll be printing on. So it's already selected. Great. Paper size, as I said, we're gonna do a 13 by 19 print, which is referred to as an A3 plus. So we'll check that. And then print quality, for some reason it tends to default to standard. So just always move that up to highest. And the paper source, we're going to do manual feed. So typically with high-end printers, you're going to have two feed settings, either through the top or through the rear, which in this case is called manual feed, the rear feed. And it, when you're using a thicker paper, which the soft gloss rag is a thicker paper, I believe it's 16 or 18 mil thick, you really need to put it through the rear. It's going to come in at a gentler angle. It's just going to work better. It's going to give you an overall better result. You're not going to get any scraping on the print heads, which can leave streaks. So that's all good. Next thing we're going to do is go into main. And the only thing we're going to touch here is advanced settings and the print head height. This is something you want to be mindful of. So as you can see, I have it set to avoid paper abrasion. There's just two options, default and avoid abrasion. When you select avoid abrasion, again, working with thicker paper, it's actually gonna lift the print heads up a little bit with the actual hardware inside of the printer. And it's gonna give you a better result. You know, once you get up to that, you know, 16, 18 mil area, it's a tight fit. So you wanna give it a little more room to breathe to avoid streaking. Okay, so that's all good. For the rendering intent, I would recommend setting this to relative colorimetric. So what that's going to do versus something like perceptual or absolute is basically preserve the color detail from the original photo the best. You're going to get the most color accuracy. And another thing I should mention is when it comes to color accuracy, you should really be using an RGB calibratable monitor so that what you see on your screen is identical to what you get out of the printer. BenQ has some good options here, but that's an important thing if you're gonna get into this seriously and create a workflow for yourself. Okay, the last thing we want to be mindful of is the printer profile. So you can see here, I already have it set to Red River Palo Duro Soft Gloss Rag, but you can see I have almost 100 profiles in here. So with any paper, there's always going to be an ICC profile that you can download online from the manufacturer's website. Red River makes these very accessible. It's a quick process. You can just Google it. There'll be information as to which folder you want to store that in, and then it'll link right up to Photoshop. And that's going to make sure that the color accuracy and everything about the print is aligned with the paper. Okay. We're ready to print. We're going to click print. Okay, so now the printer is saying, hey, we've received a print command. Can you please confirm that there is actually paper in the rare tray? So what I need to do is now go over to the printer, load up a sheet of paper, and just let it know that we're all good to go. All right, now we are ready to print. We're going to open up the printer. You can see that dialog box I had mentioned. When you handle the paper, if this is for a client, you really shouldn't be touching it with your bare hands because the oils in your skin are going to deposit on here. Just try to hold it by the edge when you touch it. Make sure you have the right side, the principal side, facing up. And then we're going to put this in. Okay, so I've got my paper loaded, the printer set up. Now I'm just going to accept the print command. And now we just wait. This takes 5 minutes or so. That noise that you hear is the printer. That noise you hear is the printer agitating the ink tanks. Print's all done, and here's the final product. Not bad. Well, I hope that you've all learned something, from the editing process and the printing process. Really what this is all about is getting a handle on all the tools at your disposal so that you can try and recreate some of the feeling, tone, and emotion that you actually experienced when you were out in the field capturing your images, and share that with an audience. And that leads us into the next step of the process, which is getting ready for the exhibit. So stay tuned for the next episode where we'll take all the prints that are gonna be going into this exhibit, 77 total, and begin to mount those onto foam core board, as well as apply a protective varnish since the exhibit's gonna go for 6 months. Again, thank you to Red River, and thank you all for your attention. Please reach out if you have any additional questions. All right, take care, bye-bye.